And I think while our vice chair is doing that, we can start the process just to get things rolling, and hopefully she'll be able to pop in just a second. So good morning, everybody. The time is 10:02, and I call the September 15, 2022 Planning Board meeting to order. We are joined by Vice Chair Bailey. We have Commissioners Washington, Dorner, and Giraldo, as well as myself, Chair Shapiro. Moving forward to the business at hand, please note that the deadline for all participant pre-registration and for all submission of materials and exhibits was 12 noon on the Tuesday before this Planning Board meeting. The deadline is shown on the screen, and it's announced in every weekly meeting and posted on our website as well. Registered speakers may join the meeting with the link provided in the email provided by the Planning Board office or listen by phone by utilizing the call-in number provided in the email. Of course, anyone can tune in to watch the Planning Board meeting via live stream. If you wish to speak or become a person of record, you may use our online web form, which you'll see noted on the screen. In addition to the commissioners, we are joined by David Warner, our principal counsel. Note we're joined by Delisa Coleman, our associate general counsel. We are also joined by Director Checkley, Planning Director Checkley. We have Jessica Jones, our Planning Board Administrator, Joe Parsons, our technical hearing writer, James Hunt, Division Chief, Development Review Division. And we have staff members Kenneth Flanagan and Ryan Cram, who are helping out with our technology. Madam Vice Chair, can we hear you? No, we still can't hear you. Can you call in? It happens to somebody every meeting, so it's your turn, unfortunately. But if you can call in and then turn off your mic, and then you'll have a separate call-in. The call-in number she has? One, we have a resolution in support of Francis Tiafoe Day in Prince George's County. So for anybody who has been
watching,
how about living under a rock and hasn't heard, Francis Tiafoe, our very own, was in the semifinals of the U.S. Open. He's a native of Hyattsville in Prince George's County, resided in Riverdale Park and College Park, and he again recently reached his first Grand Slam semifinal during the 2022 U.S. Open Championships. First American man to reach the tournaments to semifinals in the tournaments in 16 years, and the first African American man to make the U.S. Open semifinals in 50 years. This is an amazing accomplishment. He is a local guy. He began playing tennis at the age of 4 and trained at the Junior Tennis Championships Club, the JTCC in College Park, which has a long-standing partnership with the Maryland National Capital Park and Planning Commission. We are their landlord, and we are in partnership with them on the activities that they provide. He had a very successful junior tennis career. He's also the recipient of the 2020 Arthur Ashe Humanitarian Award from the ATP for all of his good work outside the tennis board as well. This resolution supports the county executives declaring September 16th as Francis Tiafoe Day in Prince George's County. And there's a welcome home party for him tomorrow, late afternoon, for those of you who are interested in that as well. So very, very excited about this resolution. Love his connection to the county, and we're excited to see his great future. So with that, is there a motion to adopt the resolution?
Move approval.
Enthusiastically second. It's such a great story.
Really is. So we have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion on the motion? Seeing none, I'll call the roll. Commissioner Giraldo.
I vote aye, and just for comment, it was his play against Nadal was outstanding.
Oh my God. Truly. Commissioner Washington.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Dorner.
Yes.
Vice Chair Bailey, just nod your head.
Yes.
We have a head nod. And I vote aye as well. The ayes have it 5-0 for the resolution in support of Francis Tiafoe Day in Prince George's County. Next item. I think we have an echo. It may be, is it Vice Chair Bailey? All right. Do you want to take a 1 or 2 minute break while we figure this out, or you're good to go? Okay. Because we're getting echo over here on our side.
I'm getting to hear it on my side as well. I'm hearing it.
Are we good? Anybody hear it now? I don't hear it. I think we've worked it out on our side. Okay. All right. So we'll go to the next item on our agenda, which is draft minutes. Is there a motion to approve the draft minutes of September 8th, 2022?
Move approval.
Second.
We have a motion by Commissioner Washington, second by Commissioner Giraldo. Discussion on the motion. I'll call the roll. Commissioner Washington.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Giraldo.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Dorner.
Vote aye.
I don't see Commissioner Bailey.
Hello.
Okay. Do you vote aye on the motion to approve the draft minutes, Madam Vice Chair?
Vote aye. Bailey.
I vote aye as well. The ayes have it 5-0 to approve the draft minutes. Next item, we have a legislative work session. We have Ms. Hightower is going to be presenting, and we have two items, CB 91, 2022, and CB 92, 2022. Do we have Ms. Hightower? We do not.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, she may be in another session that's going on this morning. We'll double check in there, but if it pleases the board to proceed with the agenda, that's fine. We'll circle back around.
Okay, thank you. We'll get to these items later on the agenda. Hold on one sec for more technical issues first. Hold on. Thank you. Our vice chair is going to stay. She is in the meeting, and she's going to stay on audio, but not video. But we do hear her, and she hears us. Madam Vice Chair, you hear us?
I can hear you. Can you hear me?
We can. So she is a full participant, but we'll be participating on audio. So let's move on to the next agenda, which is item 3C. It's a Parks and Recreation update. This is for our information only, but this is a athletic field improvements plan. We have Mr. Turnbull, Mr. Coates. Of course, we're also joined by Steve Carter and our director, Mr. Bill Tyler. Let me turn to you, Mr. Tyler, for how you want to take up this presentation with you and your team. And I may have left somebody off, but I'll turn it over to you.
Good morning, and thank you so much, Mr. Chair and Madam Vice Chair and Planning Board members. Great to see you as always today, and we have an exciting presentation. So I'm going to turn it over to Deputy Director Carter and his team to provide this presentation. We're very excited about it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning once again, everyone. Director Tyler, thank you. And sometimes we are remiss and don't thank you for your leadership and allowing your executive leadership team to lead, inspire, and pursue greatness every day. That is our motto, and that is what the planning board members were here today. But let me set this up for you. Today, you're going to hear from Parks and Recreation professionals about a new approach to our athletic field maintenance program. Our goal is to align our athletic field maintenance standards with industry best practices so that we are recognized as the best of the best. A few highlights for all of you. In March of 2022, it was the first time in the commission where we had 100 baseball, softball, and rectangular fields ready for our residents. We found out that our neighboring jurisdiction, DC, Montgomery County, Howard County, and Arundel, they were opening their ball fields on March the 15th. So the teams from Northern Region, Southern Region, and our youth sports team got together and came up with a plan. And we actually got recognized by the county exec and her team for also being ready to have fields ready for our young boys and young girls to participate in Prince George's County. That's one highlight. As you know, we have 297 fields across the commission. But today you're going to hear about what is a level one field, what's a level two field, and what's a level three field and why. You will also hear about agronomy, soil management, soil quality, aerification and the importance of it, top dressing, and overseeding. And We have to educate the public, because eventually we will be taking out some of these ball fields, meaning taking them out for play in order for us to recondition them so we can continue to strive to be the best of the best. And finally, the team will share how this organization will work towards pursuing greatness as it relates to athletic field maintenance standards. So without further ado, I will turn it over to Dean Turnbull, who will introduce the team that have made this happen thus far and will continue to strive so we can go from good to great, so we can host many more athletic tournaments in Prince George's County. Thank you for your time, and I will turn it over to Dean.
Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. Good morning, members of the board and Chair Shapiro. We greatly appreciate the opportunity to share this information with you this morning. I would just like to start off by introducing the team who put this information together. Anthony Potts, who is the Southern Region Parks Division Chief. Matthew Coates is the Assistant Chief for the Northern Region Parks Division. Sean Beaumont, who is currently the Recreation Maintenance Coordinator for the Northern Region Parks Division. Annette Cole, who is the Assistant Division Chief for Southern Region Parks Division, obviously with the support of Deputy Director Carter, Chief of Staff Sean Harbaugh, and ultimately Director Tyler. Next slide, please.
Hold on one second while we work out our technical issues. Okay, we're good. We can continue. Here we go.
Great. Next slide, please. So when we first started this, the commission, specifically Prince George's County, had some information related to a vision and a mission statement for park operations and maintenance. We actually reviewed that, and with everyone's efforts, we put together an athletic field management vision. And that is obviously to provide quality, safe, sustainable athletic fields for the citizens of Prince George's County. One of the things we focused on as well was equitable access across the county to the communities that we serve. Prince George's County has a lot of fields, as Deputy Director said, 297 total in the actual inventory. One of the things that we really need to look at is how do we attract more local, regional, and national tournaments to this area? And coming off the heels of the U.S. Open, this is no better time to recognize the phenomenal opportunities that we would have for providing these services. The last bullet point you see at the bottom of the slide is to align our construction and renovation techniques with the industry best practices and increase maintenance standards to maximize field usage. And we'll get into that a little bit later. Next slide, please. So what you have in front of you is you have a definition breakdown of all of our athletic fields that we currently have in our system. Level one is basically your highest use, best surface possible. And you can see we have an A1 or level 1A and level 2 or level 1B. The first one is synthetic turf, which we know we have a few in our system, which we're working currently to replace some of those surfaces. And the second one is the natural turf, which is basically where all of our competitive games are held. Level two and level three are level two are probably our highest used fields, just because those are the ones that receive the most permit play, most games. And then the level three field is your typical open space with a backstop that does not get maintained at a specific level other than maybe some mowing and maybe some agronomics, which is aerification, overseeding, and fertilization in the off season. And then our play fields, as most of us have come accustomed to, it's just an open spot where people put cones out, throw the ball around, and more passive recreation, less programmed. Next slide, please. So this really gives us a breakdown of our current inventory and permit usage. We put these numbers together at the end of June, and we have some updated numbers for you this morning. But right now, we have diamond fields at level one, we have 30, level two, we have 60, level three, 58. Rectangular, which is your football, lacrosse, rugby, we have level one, we have 12 total in the system, level two, we have 87, and level three, we have 48. But the permit hours really tell the story about how much use is on our fields. So since March, up until June, we had 70 hours of play in a northern region per day, right around 5,300 hours of permitted play total. And then the Southern Region Parks Division had 115 hours per day, and then close to 8,800 hours. Since then, our new numbers are showing that we're averaging in the Northern Region 170 hours per day, which technically it's 169.47. And if anyone knows anything about athletic field maintenance, we need to be specific about our numbers. So we are very detailed in our numbers. Right now, the commission has a total of 34,000 hours since March 15th, which is very significant. Next slide, please. So current level conditions for fields one, we kind of went over this previously. They only account for only 15% of our inventory. They've been open since April 1st. We're currently facilitating, you know, routine permitted usage. The issues that we currently have are weed encroachment, poor drainage, need to be regraded. We have a number of weather-related cancellations, which I'm sure a number of us have heard about. And one of the things we're going to focus on is updated construction specifications. We've done some recent improvements since last year, where we hired a contractor who works on major league sports fields, including the MLB as well as MLS, which is Major League Soccer. And we hired that contractor to come in and do some regrading to get us where we could actually maintain the surfaces. Next slide, please. Our level two are, as you can see, it's half of our inventory. And these fields have been open since March 15th for practice. And games actually commenced on April 1st. We're currently facilitating routine permitted usage at most fields. We have significant weed encroachment. We have obviously drainage issues. We're going to continue to work on construction specs. One of the big things for us is a workload challenge right now. So as we all know, the industry is across the board is short staffed. You know, and we're working hard to fill our positions with people who are interested in sports turf management. We've actually partnered with the University of Maryland through a PALS project to get people incorporated into the department, so we can actually utilize people who are coming out of college who have those specifications and expertise to assist our teams with the challenges that we're faced. Another one of our concerns for this, not really a concern, but it's a significant challenge, is walk-on play. So these fields are not controlled, they're unfenced. And when weather conditions aren't appropriate for use, that's typically when we have a lot of our play, because people like to get muddy. So Thanksgiving Day, a lot of football going on, right? So that's what we do in our families. We throw the pigskin around, typically on a park field or a school field, and not really understanding what the impacts of those are when you play in conditions that really aren't acceptable for play. The last concern we have for these fields is typically parking. A lot of these fields are located in neighborhoods, and they also are in parks where they're heavily programmed. So there may be multiple events going on with a shelter reservation or a park activity building being permitted out. And then we have turnover of, you know, if you have one field there, you've got typically 15 kids on each team. So that's, you know, 30 cars right there. And then you got changeover, which is about 60 cars in a parking lot just for one athletic field at one time. Next slide, please. All right, so level three is more of our, probably one of our biggest challenges. It pertains to 35% of our total inventory. These fields, as Deputy Director Carter said, were open March 15th. And they pose a big challenge for us, because typically they're in a low-lying area where a backstop or a bench was put in, where someone could fit a small-sided soccer field on. Same challenges as the level two, where you have parking concerns, aging infrastructure, but rarely these are very, very rarely permitted. Next slide, please. As I referred to earlier, we've done a lot of recent efforts on our athletic fields. We've removed vegetation mechanically, with trying to do it without the use of pesticides. We're constantly routine laying out all of our permitted rectangle fields. We recently acquired two electric utility carts, and they're GPS operated. So all you have to have is one operator, which really increases our efficiencies and maximizes our efficiencies. And what that machinery does, and I apologize for not having a slide for the recently acquired, but we just got it this past week, is that that machine can go out and paint the field without anyone steering, and it can paint a full-size soccer field in about 12 minutes with using only 50% of the paint we would use on a regular paint sprayer. So we'll have more footage for you. We'll have more video for you. We'll actually invite you out if you want to check out some of the opportunities for what we're doing as far as maintenance. Next slide, please. As you can see here, this is a video, but I don't think we're gonna have time to show the video this morning, but this is an attachment we rented that goes on the front of a skid steer. And what it's doing is it's separating the vegetation on an infield from the actual infield mix. Next slide, please. So one of our biggest challenges is probably grading, right? So a lot of our infields are low lying where the rainwater tends to drain to the infield. We've hired a contractor. We actually have a laser grader as well as our inventory. So one of our big winter projects will be regrading our infields to ensure they have proper drainage. And what that does, it sustains playability for us. So when we have rainouts, when we get an inch of rain, rather than being rained out for 24 to 48 hours, we're only rained out for 12 hours. Next slide, please. These two slides are showing what our current maintenance practices are. What you see on the left with the tractor and the blue attachment is called a shockwave. It's linear decompaction. It goes down anywhere from 6 to 12 inches into the ground. And what it does, it allows the water to drain off of the profile in through the subsurface so we can reduce rainouts. The slide on the right, the picture on the right, is a contractor, and we hire them to do deep grooming of our synthetic turf fields. And what that does, it circulates that infill mix, brings it up to the top, and then redistributes it evenly across the surface. We're learning a lot. The industry has come a long way about synthetic turf versus natural turf, and this is just one of the things that we do on a biannual basis. So twice a year we'll do a deep grooming. And then we're also required by industry standards to do GMAX. And GMAX is basically shock continuation. So when a player hits that surface, what is the reaction from that surface to that player's head or helmet or just a bare head? And this is, we're following the industry standards to do GMAX testing. We also are following closely with the NFL, the NCAA, as well as high school sports around the nation to ensure that our fields are safe and playable. Next slide, please. So this slide you're seeing right now is our current maintenance standards that we've developed in the past 2 years. We've set benchmarks, and what you'll see on the statement of standard is the maintenance activity that takes place. And we've done this for both Northern Region and Southern Region as a guideline for our staff, so they have an expectation of what we expect. And it identifies mowing on this slide, where we have regional recreational parks. The optimal standard is to mow one to 4 to 7 days. And FY21 actuals, you can see we were hitting that mark at once a week. And then FY22 estimated, we are also hitting that mark on our regional recreational. And we are proposed to hit that mark as well. The biggest challenge for us is probably our non-regional recreational parks. With our current staffing allotments and vacancies, we're right now in FY21, we are about once to 14 days. And right now in FY22 and 23, with current staffing shortages, we are 1 to 21 days and 14 to 21 days for FY23 proposed. So this kind of gives you a snapshot of what our optimal standards are. The green column is where the rest of the industry wants to be if you had unlimited resources. Next slide, please. Diamond infield maintenance, similar to what the previous slide just shows you, gives you an optimal standard. Right now we're at daily on our level ones, which are our regional recreational parks. local parks, we've kind of shift gears on that. We're really focusing on the permits that come through. And so that way, anybody who acquires a permit through the agency has a level of expectation that that field's going to be maintained at least once a week. Level three, we're basically as their permit as well. Next slide, please. This gets a little more detailed into what our current maintenance practices are. And historically, aerification, top dressing, and overseeding was done by a specialized team. And that team was limited to four people. We're actually implementing these practices into our maintenance standards for our routine teams for the Northern Region and Southern Region. We've recently acquired equipment so we can be more efficient. It's bigger equipment, it's faster, and it's more state of the art. So basically, aerification is anytime you create disturbance to allow that plant to drive its roots deeper and also create more oxygen in the soil for the plant to survive. Top dressing is after aerification, we poke holes, we'll go in and we'll provide a layer of sand to protect the crown of that plant. And then obviously overseeding is where we put grass seed down at a specific rate to ensure that we have rejuvenation and new grass seed incorporated into the soil. Next slide, please. Nutrient management. So nutrient management is going to be a big topic of discussion for us this upcoming budget season. Typically, we are fertilizing our level one fields only. And we are, for our fertilization efforts, we're required by MDE in the state of Maryland to provide records on an annual basis. There's also regulations about how much fertilizer we can provide. In previous years, people would throw out fertilizer on their yard, and you know, there was that opportunity for that fertilizer to wash into our streams and waterways. And technology has advanced the industry. So right now, there's a fertilizer we can use that goes out in the spring and it lasts for 6 to 12 weeks based on the current climate conditions. So our plan is to make sure we feed that plant both in the spring and in the fall with one application versus four or five over the course of the year. Next slide, please. So this gives you a snapshot of where our current staffing is. If you take 297 and you split that kind of in half to make it easy on us to understand, right now we have 8 total people working for the Northern Region Athletic Field Team and 11 total people working for the Southern Region Park Athletic Team. And we currently have an athletic field renovation team, which does specified maintenance practices for both Northern and Southern. That team is managed and supervised by Matthew Coates, the assistant division chief for Northern Parks Division. And there's constant communication about what the needs are between both Northern Region and Southern Region. But as you can see in the bottom, the last one, the athletic field responsibilities, athletic field team, they have 15.63 fields per person. And the renovation team is responsible for almost 74.25 fields per person. So the future staffing that we were discussing would be 12 positions for the Northern Region, 10 positions for the Southern Region. The specifications are identified there. And then an irrigation team, and then also ramping up our in-house renovation positions. So you're looking at a total of 16 plus 10, that's 26, 38 total positions. Next slide, please. So supplies and materials for FY23. As you can see, they're listed on the left-hand side of this screen, this slide. You got fertilizer, pesticide, seed, sprig, sod, top dressing material, soil, warning track material, aerification tines and blades, and those aerification tines are for what the pieces of metal that go on those pieces of equipment that make those holes in the ground, marking paint and field supplies. And right now, we're looking at, you know, over 13 million square feet that is maintained by park staff for athletic fields. Right now, our total budget, we're at $475,500. The breakdown's on the right. And then we're at 0.03, so 3 cents per square foot. That's 0.15, 1.5 cents in the northern region and 5 cents in the southern region. Next slide, please. Future material needs. We're looking at an increase of $1.5 million to enable high level of maintenance. This includes fertilizer, pesticides, seed, warning track material, you know, all the other things that go along with it, and then a 1.5 for the southern region. And the athletic field renovation team would be $2 million in order to fund the proper renovations needed. So when you see a soccer field and the goal mouth is nothing but dirt, this would allow our renovation team, along with the support of both northern region and southern region, to go in, remove that soil, regrade that area, and then put fresh sod down so we're prepared for the spring and fall. Next slide, please. Equipment needs. For us, for our teams to get around and actually do the work they need to do, this has a breakdown of what we'd be requesting for northern region and southern region, and then obviously the athletic field team with the additional people. Next slide, please. This is just a further breakdown of the equipment needs to get us up to industry standards. So technology has come a long way for sports turf and athletic field maintenance. This is just gives you an infield. It gives you a breakdown of the equipment we'd be requesting. Heavy equipment, laser grading equipment, and then obviously equipment maintenance. With technology, there's new mowers out that are on the market, and they are diesel powered with a motor, but the actual mowing things, the mowing decks, are driven by electricity, which is created from the diesel engine. And one of the things we've been talking about with our internal mechanics team is we need to ensure that they're properly trained to maintain that equipment. Next slide, please. So future renovations, we're actually looking at trying to earmark $1 million for athletic fields. What that does, it gets us 4 to 6 athletic fields renovated per season. And the renovation scopes obviously will depend on what the current conditions are of the site. So of $1 million, that's why we estimated 4 to 6, because one field might cost you $250,000 to renovate, but another one might cost you $400,000 or $500,000 based on the amenities that need to be upgraded. Next slide, please. So recently, the sports turf industry of North America, along with others around the world, gather once a year, and what they call is the Sports Turf Managers Association. They recently changed their name to the Sports Fields Managers Association. This group got together, hired a consultant similar to what the golf courses did, and they came up with a best management practices document. Of that document, there's chapters throughout the nation, because everyone's in different climate zones. So if you're in Florida, your management practices are different than you'd be in New England. So what they were talking about increased frequencies of routine maintenance costs, continuing education for people who are new to the industry. And then the last bullet was really about cultural practices and continuing improvement. So what we were trying to do is basically come up with ideas and ways to maintain our athletic fields with less inputs. And also, obviously, the end result would be more sustainable playing surfaces. Next slide, please. So total cost to sum everything up, $7.65 million. A big chunk of that is equipment. That equipment will be immortalized over 10 to 15 years based on the life of the expectancy of the equipment and use. And the ongoing cost of $7.5 million, personnel being a big chunk of that. But as you can see here, there's a big lift for supplies and materials, which is a continual thing that's gonna need to take place for infield dirt, grass seed. The cost of goods has gone significantly through the roof over the past year and a half. We used to be able to get a bag of grass seed for like $55 to $60, and now we're paying $130 to $150 based on the material type. Next slide, please. So timeline for us, FY22, we just finished up in June. We have, we're continuing, we already have, but we're continuing to recruit onboard subject matter experts. As I said earlier, we're working with the University of Maryland to do a field inventory and field assessment. Of that assessment, we'll be using the Players Condition Index, which is a national standard that sports turf managers use around the world to evaluate their not only their playing surfaces, but the amenities associated with it. We utilized a contractor to regrade and lay out 20 fields and 5 regional recreational park fields. We purchased some specialized equipment and will continue to look at opportunities to advance our technology. FY23, as you can see, we talked about the GPS painter, and I'll be sure to send over the spec sheet, information sheet on that painter so you have a good grasp of what it does. We're also talking about weather contract for monitoring systems. If you're familiar with Watkins Park or Fairland Regional Park, they're heavily used for athletic field events, And right now, we are in the business of, we really don't have a weather monitoring system that is specific to that park. And what that weather monitoring system would do for us, it would allow us to forecast whether we're going to have significant weather during the time of play. That also comes with lightning detection and will also give us an accurate amount for rainfall so we can make more data-driven decisions for field cancellations. The weather notification system is currently used by parks departments around the nation. It's called Rain Outline. What that does is it gives you an actual specific notification if you have a permit on a field and you say it's field Watkins Field 1, and Watkins Field 1 lays a lot lower than Field 2, and the water runs to Field 1. Field 2 might be open, but Field 1 will be closed, so you'll get a notification up to date. For FY24, we're looking to continue to implement nutrient management and cultural practices, continuing the evaluation of athletic field inventory in our work programs. And if funding becomes available, we can move forward with renovation plans and move closer to the optimal maintenance standards. Next slide, please. For us, that's...
Timberland, I think that's all we have. I think that's the last slide.
That concludes our presentation this morning. I just want to say thank you again for the opportunity to share this information with you. I know it's a lot of information, and I didn't want to take up too much of your time this morning, so I kind of went through it really quick. But if anyone has any questions, I'd be more than happy to try to answer those for you at this time.
I have some questions, Mr. Chair.
Yes, sir. So, Commissioner Caldo.
Thank you. What I would like, could you provide the commissioners, at least for me, I'm interested in the identify all the different fields that we have in each level. Is it?
So identify all the different fields at each level?
Right. Which field is which exactly? For example, if I wanted to know what is Tantalian North, what level field, which level does that fit in? I think it would be good to have a summary of the each type of park in each level.
Yeah, we can absolutely get that to you.
Okay. The other question I have is, we had a presentation last year when by the Parks Department about beginning to use the Bermuda grass because of a new development in it that they're using. Have we begun that process?
Yes, sir. So Fairland Field 1 is a combination Bermuda grass and bluegrass. And also at Riverdale Field 1, it's a combination of Bermuda grass and bluegrass. Our team is also working with local vendors to ensure that we can get materials to convert those fields to Bermuda grass so we can have a sustainable and more highly recoverable turf grass. But thank you for that answer. Yes, we are.
Okay. And how's that going?
Honestly, it's going really well. And the fields that are on now, it's baseball. And the issue we have with baseball is that there's not a lot of traffic in the outfield. There's a lot of traffic on the infield and the aprons, and those fields are recovering faster than cool season. well, we're getting ready to implement Bermuda grass on our rectangle fields. Probably coming late this, what would be late spring, early summer at a number of sites.
And doing your inventory of the different parks on the different levels, are you looking to see usage? For example, I know that there's some parks that have made two baseball fields and a football field, which are not really being utilized, but no soccer field.
Yeah, so go ahead, sorry.
No, I'm just particularly concerned about South County, where there's a number of other Latino soccer teams playing, and there's a lack of soccer fields.
Yeah, understood. And one of the things that we're looking at as for the two divisions is evaluating whether or not that field is appropriately built for what it's being currently used for. So you'll see backstops. We'll have public meetings. We'll talk about removing backstops, creating more rectangular spaces in a geographic area that requires that.
Okay. Thank you very much. I have no further questions, Mr. Chair.
I have a question, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Mr. Walker.
Well, first, thank you. Thank you to the entire team for the presentation. Very thoughtful, a lot of information, but you did go through it thoroughly and thoughtfully. My question relates to walk-on play. So assuming you get all the resources you've identified and, you know, the staffing, equipment, et cetera, I mean, walk-on play will continue to have an impact on our ability to sustain the fields like we want them to. So, and I didn't hear what your strategies or plans are for dealing with that.
And I apologize because I think I skipped over one of the requests would be for to work with our planning department to communicate with the public to evaluate where we can install perimeter fences. Peppermill was a recent one where we renovated a field and a perimeter fence was put up. And the message is important to our to the public, which is basically we're not keeping you off the field because the permit requirements are if the field's unpermitted, in for play. We're only going to be able to control the field when the conditions are not acceptable for play. And that's going to be a big lift for us to communicate that to the public. But there are a number of sites that we're looking at currently to request funding for perimeter fences on those level two sites.
Okay, great. Thank you, Mr. Turnbull. That's it, Mr. Chairman.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner.
I have a few questions on sustainability efforts. So I'll just kind of list them out and then you can take them as best. In terms of the vehicles and the equipment that you mentioned wanting to request, I know you mentioned that there's an electric part to some of the mowers, but are the vehicles going to be electric vehicles or hybrid to some degree? I imagine that would cost more, but it would also have more savings down the road, particularly if energy prices continue to rise. Another question I had was on the weather monitoring, whether or not you guys have looked at sort of off-the-shelf products. Something that just kind of comes to mind is, and you don't have to look at this product necessarily, but NetAtmo has like rain gauges and temperature gauges throughout the county that are sort of like open sourced for users. It typically is residential homeowners, but I think we already have at least one kind of gauge down in the Bladensburg waterfront when I'd seen it with some of the park rangers a while ago. And I was just wondering to what extent we can utilize that to maybe help kind of complement stuff. It's obviously not going to catch all of our fields and they're not going to be positioned in the places that we would want them exactly, but sort of where you're thinking of going. And then the last question is more for sustainability stuff is on the turf and, or not the turf necessarily, but the grass, whether or not we've thought about using some of our kind of agricultural aspects for germination. So have we thought about setting up greenhouses or different places that we could actually grow some types of these grasses and work with maybe local universities or ag departments to kind of think about saving on costs down the road, but figuring out how we could actually do it so it'd be sustainable where we grow them here. And maybe it doesn't take all of the needs that we have, but it at least creates some offset in the cost of where we're buying and it's locally sourced and we have job creation as a result of doing those kinds of activities as well.
Those are, So all great points, and I have a couple of responses for you. So electric vehicles, the department is looking really, really hard at electric vehicles, and electric vehicles have come a long way over the past 3 years. The issue is availability. All right. So for us, we're looking at how can we transport our teams via electric vehicles, via hybrid vehicles, and we're in current conversations with our fleet manager about attaining those vehicles. So we are looking at that, and appreciate the comment and the question about moving towards more sustainable vehicles for the operations. Weather stations for us, we're using every weather app is out there. So if something is available at a park, near a park, we're currently using that. The issue with our direction for the weather stations, WeatherBug has a lightning detection system as well as a rain gauge that can be incorporated into our irrigation system. So when it is raining, we're not overwatering the grass, but we will definitely look into the weather technology that you have referenced. The grass, as far as we call it, maybe an incubator farm or a sod farm for internal use, those current discussions are going on right now about identifying a site. We're actually looking at, you brought up greenhouse, which is a great suggestion for us. Technology right now, what we call turf blankets, we put field blankets out on fields to protect those surfaces during the wintertime. So as Mr. Manuel, Chair Manuel, or sorry, Planning Board Manuel referenced earlier, the Bermuda grass, if we can get that grass to green up faster in the spring, it's more sustainable throughout the rest of the summer. All great conversations, and anything we can do to reduce our inputs, reduce costs, we'll be definitely taking suggestions and looking into it. So thank you for your questions and comments.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Other questions? I have a few. One is that you track the field time and the field uses, and I'm curious if you've done that sort of longitudinally in any way, so we have a sense of how field usage has changed, before, during, after COVID, how that compares to other jurisdictions. So if we could see some kind of a chart that tracks it, if you've done that, but I imagine you have.
So
we'll take them one at a time. Go ahead.
We've looked at trends across the board, and unfortunately for us, the majority of our use is walk-on play, but we have permitted play, so that's driving decisions about what we do with those athletic fields. And been a lot of conversation about what the lack of programmed activities has done to athletic field surfaces since COVID began, and it actually has hurt the industry, because if you look at an infield on a baseball field, what we're doing as a cultural practice to remove weeds is disturbance. Right, so that seed doesn't germinate, and without programmed activities, a lot of people didn't step foot on infield, so it's allowed those infields to grow more weeds. And it's funny because a lot of sports turf managers will tell you that their fields are getting destroyed by the amount of play, and if you look at the amount of play versus not doing your cultural practices over the last 2 years. It's really opened up the eyes of people that it's very important to stick to that cultural practice program. But we can definitely get you that chart about permitted play from beginning of COVID, before COVID, and how we've come to where we are now.
Okay, thank you. And I was intrigued by what you said around this is related to mowing, tying the mowing schedule to when fields are going to be used. That's how I interpreted what you said. I think that was right, which seems like really efficient to me if you can pull it off. But there's that takes a lot of tracking. So I'm wondering, how that's going, and is that really going to be the future? Because you're going to be coming to us with some pretty big budget asks.
Mm-hmm.
What I'm curious about is this, mowing tied to permitting, is that actually cheaper and more efficient in the short term?
Well, that's a great question. What we've tried to do is ensure that all of our permitted athletic fields, so we get permit report once a week, and we're working with the permit office to update that to where we get a permit report on Monday morning at 5 a.m. And we know our athletic fields permitted for that week. So Monday through Thursday. And then again on Thursday morning at 5 a.m., we get a report generated for Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And our teams have an opportunity to plan their maintenance practices around that. So if we know we've got 58 sites to hit out of the 71 sites, we know we can schedule that. Without that permit info, and we've actually come to what that's done is generate a lot of conversations with our field users, because some of our field users historically know that a certain site doesn't get permitted. Well, if they don't get a, and they'll use that without getting a permit. And what that's done is they're calling us and saying, why have you mowed these fields? And we explained to them, we're basing our mowing schedule, maintenance schedule, priority first is what's permitted, and what's second is non-permitted fields. So it's actually turning our permit, it's increasing our permits for those sites, which is a double-edged sword for us, but that's kind of where we're leading to currently with the staff that we have.
Okay. All right. Very helpful. I appreciate that. Last question I have is around the budget. Wait, was somebody else going to jump in on that? No. So related to the budget, it's still not clear to me exactly, and maybe this is for Director Tyler or, you know, it's a longer conversation, but exactly what is your FY23 budget ask? How this is going to get spread out over the next few years? You know, you had the chart, but there's a lot of competing numbers in that chart.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chair. That is an ongoing process. We're still refining those numbers and prioritizing based on what the community is asking for and other competing interests. So we're still refining those numbers, and we'll be able to come back to you prior to our budget presentation and give you an update on that.
Okay. That's kind of what I was assuming, and I appreciate that. And I think what's helpful for me to hear, and perhaps all of us on the board here, is that we can expect an ask, that there's a lot of need, and we'll take it as a very positive shot across the bow that we're going to be looking for enhanced efforts. And one of the things I want to say in response to hearing this presentation is how impressed I am with how professionalized this process is getting. I mean, really, level of detail, the level of attention, working with technology, connecting to best practices, it's just great to see. It really is. It's great for the commission. It's really wonderful for the residents of the county. So nice job to all. Vice Chair Bailey. Wait, we had you, but then you muted. Go back. No? Okay. Let's just say Vice Chair Bailey is committed, engaged, and curious, and unfortunately, technology didn't cooperate. So, thank you. Other questions from commissioners? Okay. I want to thank you all for the excellent presentation, both the content and the level of detail. It was not too much. I think it was really helpful for us to hear. So I appreciate it, and we look forward to more. Thanks to all for the good work.
And thank you all for your support, as always, Mr. Chair and the Planning Board. We appreciate your willingness to listen. And this indeed was an opportunity for us to show you what is needed and required, because a lot of eyes are on our athletic fields and playing surfaces. And we do intend to be the best in the country at maintaining all of our facilities, but specifically today for our athletic fields. So we just want you to know that, and would like to invite you out to see a renovation of our fields and the maintenance up close and personal. Is really very good to see the equipment in action, how it works and what it does for the field. So we want to provide that opportunity for an invite, and we'll let you know, and hopefully you all can come out and take a look.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks, Director Tyler. Thanks to your team. I'll have a good day.
All right. Thank you.
Okay, commissioners, moving on, let's go back. I think we have Ms. Hightower with us, so we can go back to item 3A on our agenda, which is the legislative work session. It's two items, CB91 and CB92. I know that Ms. Hightower is jumping back and forth between us and the council, so we have her for a few minutes at least, and I'll turn it over to you. Take it away.
Good morning, members of the Planning Board. For the record, Raina Hightower, Intergovernmental Affairs Coordinator. CB 91, this bill will require the district council to have 8 votes, a supermajority, to adopt text amendments to local zoning laws. Staff believes that the number of votes required to adopt these legislative amendments is a policy decision to be made by the district council. Therefore, staff recommends that the planning board vote to take no position on CB 91 2022. That concludes my presentation.
We'll take these up one by one. So the first one is to create a supermajority for changes to the zoning. Staff's recommendations, we take no position because it's a policy matter. Any questions or thoughts in reaction to staff presentation on this?
I have one. I was wondering what caused or what precipitated this legislation.
I do not know, Commissioner Giraldo. I know that Chair Hawkins and Councilmember Franklin proposed it. I also know that it will be removed from the PHED committee agenda today. I do not know if it will be discussed again. It was supposed to be discussed today. And I don't know why it's been removed.
Okay. The
reason Dr. Checkley is welcome, Commissioner, if you want to hear from her.
Yes, I would.
Commissioner Giraldo.
I hear getting feedback.
Go ahead and speak.
Okay, let's move over to the mic.
Why don't you come over and sit next to me?
All of this just to say, no, we actually don't know what precipitated this amendment. And as Ms. Hightower pointed out, you know, while we may have our own personal opinions about it, we don't think that it is within our purview. It doesn't have anything to do with, you know, development per se in the county. So,
and if I can, I'm going to take my prerogative here and ask Director Checkley to share where her personal opinion is. In part because I believe it's the same personal opinion that I have. This is not the direction that I think we should go, but perhaps you could share your personal opinion and I'll join with you on it.
Well, from a staff perspective, when dealing with the zoning ordinance, you know, you all know, we just recently went through years and years of a rewrite. And so it does make sense from that perspective to, if something is going to change in what was just adopted, that it should be a general consensus of the council as opposed to just a majority of the vote. So from a staff perspective, we would like to not see wholesale changes in the zoning ordinance outside of technical necessary, you know, changes that we just spent and the county and countless residents, went through the whole rewrite procedure.
Thank you for that. And for what it's worth, that is my personal opinion as well. But I do think we are better off sticking to our general rule, which if this is a policy matter of the county council, the district council, that we should leave that to them and not weigh in on that. So I do think that's a better process for us if we just take no position, despite my personal feelings and Director Shetty. Other questions on this? Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
So with that, the recommendation is for us to take no position. Is there a motion to that effect?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we take no position on CB 91-2022.
I'll second that.
Motion is second. Discussion? I'll call the roll. Commissioner Washington.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Giraldo.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Dorner.
Good eye.
Vice Chair Bailey. We may not have her. I vote aye. There we go. Head nod, just in case. There we go. She votes aye. I vote aye as well. Ayes have it 5-0. Turn back to Ms. Hightower for our next item, CB 92.
This bill will eliminate the district council's election to review development review applications under the zoning ordinance. The election to review processes cause uncertainty, subjectivity, unpredictable time and costs within the development review process. This process is one of the county's most significant barriers to development. Neighboring jurisdictions do not have this process. The elimination of the election to review process will do more to facilitate the type of high quality development the county demands and deserves. Our state-of-the-art zoning ordinance contains objective development regulations and standards to guide the development review approval process. The new ordinance and review of the master plans is the most effective tool for the district council to direct development and accomplish their goal, their land use goals. Staff has recommended several technical amendments that should be made to the bill, which include formatting. Staff commends the district council as this bill with amendments is a step in the right direction. Staff recommends that the planning board vote to support CB 92 with amendments. That concludes my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hightower. I'm excited to see this coming forward. It feels long overdue. And this is me in previous roles, former council member, running a development finances agency for the county. And in my current role, I can't tell you how many times I've heard how problematic this policy is. And Vice Chair Bailey, when you and I were council members, in fairness, I had a slightly different view back then. But I get it, right? Right, that's just the way it is. It's a different lens. I'm glad this is moving forward, and I would encourage us to support staff's position and support this legislation. So questions or comments from planning board members? Mr. Giraldo, you have one?
No, I kind of favor it. I thought about it a lot, and some of it was already in when we were doing the zoning rewrite, and then it was taken out. So I'm glad to see it back in where it limits the council's participation in that. I've always thought that our planning staff is one of the best in the region, and that when they make decisions, that those decisions should stand. That's a personal view. I know that's not what the law is. So I find this going in the direction of allowing the planning staff to do its good work.
Thank you. But associate myself with those remarks. Other commissioners, questions, comments? Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Thank you all very much. Is there a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept the recommendation of staff and support CB 92, 2022 with amendments.
I'll second that.
We have a motion and a second. Discussion of the motion? I'll call the roll. Commissioner Washington.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Giraldo.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Dorner.
Aye.
Vice Chair Bailey. She votes aye. I vote aye as well. Ayes have it 5-0. Thank you, everybody. Thanks, Ms. Hightower. Back to the council with you, I think. Next item on our agenda, we have consent agenda. We have a few items on the consent agenda, items 4D, E, and F. Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda?
Move approval, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
Motion is second on consent agenda items. Discussion of the motion. I'll call the roll. Commissioner Washington.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Giraldo.
Vote aye, Mr. Chair.
Commissioner Horner.
Vote aye.
Vice Chair Bailey. She votes aye as well. I vote aye as well. Ayes have it 5-0 on the consent agenda. Hold on 1 second for me. Staff wants me to clarify that the motion and the second was related to items 4D, E, and F, all three items. That's the maker of the motion, correct?
That is correct.
I accept it.
Correct.
Yes.
And that's what we voted on. Okay, so it's items 4D, 4E, and 4F. Thank you. And I call the roll. Yep, so we're good to go on that. So next we have items 5 and 6. These are actually, this is the regular agenda. Items 5 and 6 are companion cases. So we'll take them up as one discussion, though if we move to action, we'll be voting on them separately. So this is items 5, 6 companion cases, detailed site plan departure from parking and loading spaces, DSP 21045 and DPLS 22002, the Cassidy. For the staff reviewer is Ms. Butler. The attorney for the applicant is Mr. Haller. There may be other speakers as well. We'll determine that as we move along. And I'll turn it over to Ms. Butler.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and members of the Planning Board. For the record, I'm Tierra Butler with the Urban Design Section. The project before you is item number 5 and 6, detailed site plan, DSP-45 and DPLS-22002 for the Cassidy, which is a detailed site plan for the development of a 175 multifamily dwelling units within 3 buildings and a companion departure for parking and loading spaces for the reduction of 168 parking spaces to allow a total of 263 spaces. Next slide, please. This site is located in Prince George's County Planning Area 75A in Council District 6, as shown in the magenta colored area on the map. Next slide, please. This site is located approximately 70 feet east of the intersection of Ronald Road and Karen Boulevard. The site boundary is shown in red on the vicinity map. Next slide, please. The subject property is zoned residential RMF-20 under the current zoning ordinance, as shown in the orange color on the zoning map shown on the left side of the screen. The subject property is zoned residential R-18 under the prior zoning ordinance, as shown in the brown color on the zoning map shown on the right side of the screen. Next slide, please. This slide shows the site is located within the military installation overlay zone. Next slide, please. This slide shows the aerial photo, which shows the existing conditions of the property, which shows the site is currently vacant and wooded. Next slide, please. This site contains slopes, as shown with the red contour lines on the map. Next slide, please. This slide shows the master plan right-of-way, which identifies Karen Boulevard as a collector roadway, as outlined in green, South Addison Road and Walker Mill Road as an arterial roadway, as outlined in red. Next slide, please. This slide shows the bird's eye view of the property, which shows that the site is vacant and wooded, and then the Addison Road metro station is located further north along Addison Road. Next slide, please. This slide shows the proposed development for the 175 multifamily units within 3 buildings. Each building will be 4 stories and approximately 51 feet tall at its highest elevation. The site will be accessed from a single entrance along Karen Boulevard. Building 1 will contain a total of 77 dwelling units. Building 2 will contain a total of 63 dwelling units. Building 3 will contain a total of 35 dwelling units, and the clubhouse will be 3,596 square feet and located adjacent to building 3. A total of 263 surface parking spaces are provided on the site and will have 1 loading space. A companion departure from parking and loading standards has been filed in conjunction with this DSP to allow for the reduction of 168 parking spaces, and the stormwater management facilities will be provided on site near the entrance and adjacent to Karen Boulevard. As previously stated, the applicant is requesting a reduction of 168 parking spaces to provide a total of 263 spaces. The applicant has conducted a parking analysis that demonstrated that the peak parking demand is 226 parking spaces Monday to Friday and 214 spaces on Saturday. The parking analysis determined that the peak parking demand will support the applicant's proposal of 263 parking spaces. The analysis that the parking needs are proposed from a project range ranging from a minimum of 226 spaces to a maximum of 259 parking spaces. And the development proposes 263 spaces, which will exceed the maximum demand according to the analysis. And in addition to the providing adequate parking, the property is within 1.1 mile of the Addison Road Metro Station, and there are two bus stops within easy walking distance. The property is served by public transit, which will further reduce the need for parking. And staff has reviewed and is in support of the departure. And then supplemental backup includes the transportation referral that was submitted on time. Next slide, please. This slide shows the proposed signage. The site proposes a freestanding sign located at the entrance of the site near Karen Boulevard. The proposed sign will be 6 feet tall and 8 feet wide. The sign will contain gray brick base with gray asphalt framing and black metal lettering that will read the Cassidy. Next slide, please. This slide shows the landscape plan. The landscape plan provided with the subject DSP contains the required schedules and demonstrates conformance with the landscape manual. Next slide, please. This slide shows the type 2 tree conservation plan. Next slide, please. This slide shows the architectural site plan, which shows the location of the three buildings and the clubhouse. Next slide. This slide shows the architectural elevations. The proposed building will consist of a combination of white and light gray facing brick with white cast stone. The building will have vertical siding and trim boards. Each building will be approximately 51 feet high from its tallest elevation and will contain shingle roofs. Next slide, please. This slide shows the architectural elevations for building one. Next slide, please. This slide shows the architectural elevations for building two. Next slide, please. This slide shows the architectural elevations for building three. Next slide, please. And this last architectural elevation slide shows the elevations for the clubhouse. Next slide, please. And with that, urban design staff recommends that planning board adopt the findings of this report and approve detailed site plan DSP-21045 for the Cassidy and type 2 tree conservation plan TCP-2-077-04-03, subject to the conditions found on page 14 of the staff report, and approve the departure of parking and loading standards, DPLS-22002, for the reduction of 168 parking spaces to allow 263 spaces. And the applicant has submitted revised conditions as part of the additional backup to eliminate condition number 5. And then both the urban design staff and the park and recreation staff are in agreement with removal of the condition. And this concludes staff's presentation.
Thank you, Ms. Butler. Mm-hmm. Question for staff from board members.
I just want to know what the rationale is for removing condition 4 with regards to the location and width of the internal trails.
Condition number five, the justification was for feasibility purposes.
No, number four, isn't it? I'm looking at it.
It was a renumbering, but the only condition removed was
right. Yes, that is correct.
What's correct?
I can address that in my
presentation. It's correct that there was a renumbering and it was the removal of condition number five, and then that resulted in a renumbering. But the condition number five is in reference to the soft surface trail and connection to the eastern property boundary between the subject property and Prince George's County Board of Education, and then the Walker Middle School. Is that what you're referring to? Condition number five.
No, but I'm looking at the staff report of August 30th, where it says here currently conditions 4, 7, 8, 13, 8, the following: number 4, location and width of the internal trails proposed shall be evaluated, determined by the trails coordinator prior to phase two approval. And then on page 3, the applicant is requesting this condition to leave.
I'm speaking away.
So on page 3 of the staff report, dated August 30th, 2022, it states currently conditions 4, 7, and 8 and 13 state the following. Number 4 says the location and width of the internal trails proposed shall be evaluated and determined by the trails coordinator prior to phase two approval. Then you go down and then it says the original conditions will be numbered with the deletion of condition 4. And the applicant requested deletion of condition 4. So I just want to know the rationale for it.
The rationale was for feasibility purposes for the connection. There was a minimal boundary line between Walker Mill Middle School, and it was determined that it wasn't feasible due to the construction for Walker Mill Middle School. So that was the primary reason for the removal was for feasibility purposes.
Okay. It also seems that you're referencing a different staff report, Commissioner.
I am. Yeah. I am. It's number alternate. I'm reading it under the basic plan amendment to Kenwood Village.
I think you got the wrong case in front of you.
Wrong case,
Commissioner. Oh, okay. My bad.
No, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I thought you were referring to the connection, which is condition number 5 that was renumbered.
Strike my question.
Okay. All right. So that's all right, Commissioner Giraldo. So any questions? Any other questions you have related to this case?
No.
All right. Commissioners, any other questions for staff? Okay, no questions. We have no one signed up to speak for this beyond the applicant and their team. Is that correct? I believe we have no one signed up to speak, so let me turn it over to just to let everybody know.
There are some folks who have signed up to some applicants team.
With the applicants team, right. So as is often the case, there's a whole lot of work that's gone on behind the scenes to make this possible. Appreciate all the staff's time. Let me turn it over to Mr. Haller and see where you want to go with this. Again, there's no opposition, and I appreciate all the work that's been done. But anything that you want to bring to this or introduce members of the team as well, I'll leave it to you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I will be very brief. As you noted, there's always a lot of work that goes on behind the scenes on cases like this. And we want to thank all of staff, and particularly Ms. Butler, for her work in getting us to this point. I do want to just note that we have several representatives of the team before you today. This project called the Cassidy is actually a partnership between Streetscape Partners and KCG. This is not the first partnership project that you've seen before you. The most recent project that the planning board approved was for an affordable senior housing apartment project in the Traditions at Beachfield planned retirement community. You had that in front of you a few months ago, and that project is proceeding. This is a second project that the two are working on together, and this is again for an affordable housing project in Prince George's County. I have with me today Mr. Ben Bullock with Streetscape Partners and Ms. Mo McCray with KCG, and they're here to answer any questions that you have specifically about the project. We also have representatives of our engineers and architects, as well as our traffic consultant on the call if there are any questions. I don't really have a whole lot to add, just to note that this property was part of a larger tract of land that was subdivided back in 2004. And it consisted of two components. On the west side of the road was 24 townhouse units. And on the east side of the road were apartments that were proposed. And Karen Boulevard at that time was not connecting all the way through. And as part of the development of the townhouses, Karen Boulevard was then connected. And as you see from the aerial photograph that's shown on the screen, it now connects up to the Walker Mill Middle School. The townhouses were constructed right before the recession that hit back in 2008. Apartments didn't make it, however, and therefore they never went forward. But the recession did create the opportunity for this partnership to be able to come together and to now propose the project that you see before you today. So I just wanted to give the planning board just a small bit of that background. And but similar to the Traditions at Beachfield project, this is another attractive, high quality project that will provide affordable housing to Prince George's County and will truly enhance the surrounding area. So we're happy to answer any questions that the planning board may have. If there are questions about the deletion of condition 5, I'm happy to provide more details of that as well.
Thank you, Mr. Haller. So commissioners, questions for the development team, Mr. Bullock, Ms. McCray, related to this project? Don't see any. The only question I have is around the affordability. If you could talk, Ms. McCray or Mr. Bullock, if you could talk a little bit about the financing mechanism for the affordability, what's the affordability rates, all those things. And it's an exciting project, by the way, and we're glad that you're doing it. But jump in with that at least.
Sure, I can jump in here. This
project will be a 4% welcome housing tax credit. Ms. McCray, we're having a little trouble hearing you. Your audio is a bit muffled.
Is it okay? No? Okay. Hold on.
There's a little technical issues today.
If can you hear me any better than
Mr. Bullock, we hear you fine.
Okay, great. Mo is the tax credit expert. I'm more on the development side, but I'll give you my best elevator pitch.
Let me just ask, is it a low-income housing tax credit deal?
Yes, it's a 4% low-income housing tax credit deal that's going to be financed with tax-exempt bonds. We have been talking to a number of financing partners about the project. Incomes will be at 60% of the area median income, and it's intended to be a family project. So we have one, two, and a number of three-bedroom units in the project, which we're very pleased to be able to provide. And we have worked with the Prince George's County staff to work on a pilot, so payment in lieu of taxes to help alleviate some of the operating expenses for the project. And have had a great working relationship with staff and look forward to doing other things in the county. The only other thing I might mention is the name Cassidy. The Cassidy is something that we think is kind of neat and thought you guys might appreciate. It's named after Eva Cassidy, who was a jazz singer from Prince George's County, who became quite famous a couple of decades ago for her collaborations with Chuck Brown. So we think it's kind of a neat nod to Prince George's County history, and thought that might be something that y'all were interested in.
You just made me very happy. That's a lovely story. I appreciate you sharing it.
Yeah.
So thanks for the information related to financing.
If Ben got it all right, there'll be tax credits and bonds. The bonds will be issued by Prince George's County. And so we're trying to make this as local as possible from the financing side of the house. We also have a pilot, and we will be having HIF funds, so that's their trust fund there at DHCD for the county overall. And I have nothing to add. All 60%, 1s, 2s, and 3s.
Right. Thank you. Thanks to both of you. Who's issuing the bonds? Is it the Housing Authority?
It's the Housing Authority.
Okay, great. Good. Wonderful. Sounds like a great partnership, and I appreciate all the time and effort that's gone into this. Commissioners, other questions for the applicant? Seeing none, thank you all for your time on this. Let me verify that there's nobody else who signed up to speak on this. Is that correct? So with that, if there's nothing else for, no other questions for the applicant or for staff, commissioners, what's your pleasure on this?
I'll make a motion, but I also want to say thank you for the EVA cast. That's pretty cool. That's really cool, actually. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I move that we adopt the findings of staff and approve DSP-21045 and TCP-2-077-04-03, along with the conditions as outlined in staff's report and as further modified by applicant exhibit number 1, in addition to approving DPLS-22002.
I'll second that, but I also want to apologize to Ms. Butler for being on the wrong page. I think Ms. Commissioner Washington said I must still be on summer vacation. I think I am. But thank you, Ms. Butler.
Thank you. Questions for Ms. Coleman. Are we okay with taking up both these issues in one vote, or do you want us to separate them out?
You are okay. I've seen it done that way previously, so you're fine.
Okay. I'm fine with it as long as you're fine with it too. So the vote is, the motion is for both cases, DSP 21045 and DPLS 22002. As read by Commissioner Washington. That's the motion. Is there a second to the motion?
Second.
We have that already? Okay. Any further discussion on the motion? Not, I'll call the roll. Commissioner Washington. I'm sorry, there is discussion?
Yeah, just under discussion, I just wanted to point out that this is the second week in a row that Mr. Aller has brought non-market rate development to us for review, and I certainly appreciate that. It doesn't go unnoticed, and I think it's nice to see us looking more towards affordable housing and looking at other options within the county and not just building brand new homes at extremely high prices. Although it's great to attract new folks and new tax base, it's also really nice to see LIHTC coming in here and building out this for other people in the county that potentially have a greater need for affordable housing. So thank you for doing that.
Thank you.
Well said. Well said, Commissioner Dorner. I would associate myself with those remarks as well. I think it's great to see. So with that, I'll call the roll. Commissioner Washington?
I vote aye, and I also associate myself with Commissioner Dorner's comments. Thank you, Mr. Howler and team.
Commissioner Giraldo?
Vote aye. Thank you again.
Commissioner Dorner?
Vote aye.
Vice Chair Bailey stepped away. I vote aye as well. The ayes have it 4-0. Thank you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Have a great afternoon.
Thank you all.
With that concludes all the items for today's agenda. And Mr. Hunt, is there any further business to come before the planning board today?
Mr. Chair, members of the board, there are no additional planning board items before you today. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So without objection, the meeting is adjourned. Thanks, everybody. Have a good day.
This conference is no longer being recorded.